guys. How are you? Hey, I'm just going through a book that I had worked on when I was writing poetry a while back. It is still something I love to do, but I don't do it as often as I would love to. Now, poetry is a different kind of art form that we can do with our words. Sometimes poems rhyme, sometimes they don't. But it's something that I think you should always keep track of your work, because you can see how much you've grown and you can remember what you were thinking when you wrote it, because usually poetry and your writing comes best when it's from your heart and what's inside, okay? But we know why you're here. Not to read my old poems that I wrote years ago, but you are here for our next thrilling chapter, chapter 5 of Bunnicula by James and Deborah Howe. Chapter 5, Chester goes into his act. The next morning I was awakened by a scream. Robert! Robert! Come down here right away! There's something wrong in the kitchen! For a moment, panic seized me. I thought she'd run out of dog food. But then I remembered the events from the previous evening. Mr. Monroe came bounding down the stairs. Chester! Chester! I cried. Did you see Mr. Monroe? His face has turned white. It's Bunnicula, isn't it?
No, he said calmly. It's shaving cream, you idiot!
By now, the excitement in the kitchen was at full throttle. The table was covered in Bunnicula's handiwork. There were white beans and white peas and white squash and white tomatoes and white lettuce and white zucchini. What can it be, Robert? Miss Monroe was saying. I'm getting worried. One tomato is a curiosity, but this is unheard of.
Oh, there must be something wrong with our refrigerator. That's it. It's turning all the vegetables white.
But look, she said, I left these tomatoes on the windowsill, and they're white too. And this squash, I left in the bowl on the table.
At that moment, Pete and Toby came into the kitchen.
Holy cow, what's going on? Hey, maybe it's a vegetable blight, Mom.
Could that be, Robert? Did you ever hear of anything like that?
Oh, well, no, actually. That is, I've heard of a blight, but nothing like this.
Chester leaned my way.
This will take forever if we could leave it up to them. Sometimes human beings can be so slow.
I started to answer him, but he was heading for the table.
What about that friend of yours in the agriculture department?
Oh, Tom Cragen?
Could we call him and ask him if we're doing something wrong?
It's DDT, Mom.
Peter interjected.
I know about this stuff. It's because you buy vegetables that aren't organic.
All vegetables are organic, Peter,
Miss Monroe replied.
That's not what my teacher says. See, Toby, I told you this would happen. They're using chemicals on our food, and if you're not careful, you'll turn white too.
Like Dad?
Robert, couldn't you take that shaving cream off your face?
Oh, yes, of course. Where's my towel? I know I brought it down with me.
For that matter, where was Chester? I'd seen him going around the table, but I'd lost track of him listening to all that talk about DDT. I just hoped they didn't do any of that stuff where they grew chocolate cupcakes.
Pete, did you take my towel?
Why would I take your towel, Dad? I don't shave.
Just then the door swung open. I could not believe my eyes. There was Chester with Mr. Monroe's towel draped across his back and tied under his neck like a cape. That was strange enough, but on his face was the expression that sent chills down my spine. His eyes were wide and staring. The corners of his mouth were pulled back in an evil grimace. His teeth were bared and gleaming in the morning light. He menacingly and threw back his head as if he were laughing at us all. I thought he'd completely lost his mind.
There's my towel. What's the matter? Chester, were you cold?
Mr. Monroe bent down to take the towel from Chester. Before he could lay the hands on it, Chester flipped over onto his back, closed his eyes, and folded his paws over his chest. It was a hideous sight. He opened his eyes wide, with paws outstretched. He slowly lifted his head, his eyes glazed and vacant. Soon the upper half of his body followed, all in one smooth flow, until he was in a sitting position.
Hey, Dad,
did you leave your brandy glass out last night? Chester is acting a little weird.
Well, son, cats are funny creatures. I glanced at Chester. He wasn't laughing.
Psst, Chester, what are you up to?
I'm a vampire, you dolt. Can't you tell? I'm trying to warn them.
Well, it isn't working. You'd better think of something else, Chester. Chester frowned, apparently deep in thought.
So you see, Toby,
Mr. Monroe was explaining, all cats are as individuals as people.
Maybe he just wants to get our attention. Isn't that right, kitty cat?
Ordinarily, Chester would have left the room upon being called kitty cat, but he was lost in thought.
Come on, Chester, give me back my towel.
Mr. Monroe moved towards Chester.
Chester's eyes lit up. He looked at me and smiled. I sensed I was not going to like what he had in mind. I was toying with the notion of sinking under the table when Chester fixed me with his eyes. How deep they were, like black pools. I felt myself floating, lost in them. My will no longer my own. I felt an inexplicable urge to murmur, "Yes, master." When he walked slowly, steadily towards me, as he drew nearer, I found myself unable to move. He stopped before me, never taking his gaze off me, and lunged.
Yow! Mom, Chester bit Harold on the neck.
Aw, that wasn't a real bite, was it, Chester? That was a love bite. Isn't that cute?
Love bite my foot, that hurt!
Chester, what's the matter with you? I spluttered.
Do I look like a tomato?
No. It doesn't matter anyway, Harold. They don't understand. How can human beings read the same books I do and still be so thick?
Our conversation was interrupted. Miss Monroe picked up Chester up and cuddled him. I was praying she would not add insult to injury by kissing his nose, which he hates more than anything.
Poor Chester. Do you need a little love? Do you know what I'm going to do, you big ball of fuzz, you? Oh, I could tell what was coming. I'm going to kiss you on your little nose.
Yep, I could tell. That was coming. All right. Chester knew better than to resist. He went limp in Miss Monroe's arms. Mr. Monroe took his towel off Chester.
I still don't know why he's wearing my towel, he said. I think he must be cold, dear. Here's your towel. Why don't you get his kitty sweater?
Chester looked ill.
And he can wear that all day.
As Chester was being buttoned into his bright yellow sweater with purple mice and cowboy hats all over it, Mr. Monroe said,
"What about those vegetables? Shall I speak with Tom Cragen?"
"Yes, dear," Miss Monroe said. "Why don't you? I'm sure there's some explanation. In the meantime, I'll change markets. To tell you the truth, I'm really much more worried about Chester. We'd better keep an eye on him."
Chester?
And I did not speak until late afternoon. I was busy nursing my neck, and Chester was busy hiding under the sofa, too embarrassed to be seen. When he did speak, at last, it was a brief exchange.
"Hey, Chester,"
I called when he finally crawled out from under.
"We don't have to worry about any vampire bunnies anymore. All you have to do is stand outside his cage in that sweater, and he'll laugh himself to death."
Chester was not amused.
"That's right. Make fun, all of you. No one understands. I tried to warn them, and they wouldn't heed. Now, I'm going to take matters into my own hands."
Whereupon, Chester and his 16 purple mice went into the kitchen for dinner. All right, my friends, that does it for the end of Chapter 5. Now, you do have some questions to answer. Make sure you do your best. Answer them with complete sentences if it's asked. Make sure you do all the steps. Make sure you upload the file and click submit. Have a great rest of your day.